there is a mother next to you, would you tell them Happy Mother's Day, please? Alright, turn to another one, tell them Happy Mother's. Turn to the next one, tell them Happy Mother's Day. We honor the mothers in house. Hallelujah. Right, you have that so? Then you can just take our seat. Thank you very much. The Lord bless you. Allow me to appreciate Dad and my mom in the house who in absentia. Bishop and Mamalis, they have gone to lounge to the Deliverance Chemirema Drive Church. And then from there, Deliverance Kahawes, they are celebrating 25 years today since they were planted from here. Yeah, it's a people from this church, so he's also going there for the anniversary. Amen. Thank you very much. On behalf of myself and my wife, Pastor Anne, I want to really, really from the bottom of our hearts, and from the deepest of our hearts, to really appreciate all of you. Thank you very much for your gift, your prayers. And you're turning up yesterday, those who, many people were not able to come, but they gave the apologies and sent their contribution as well as in funds for my mom on behalf of the Destiny family. Destiny family is a Raja family. My dad is called Yeshu. So brothers and sisters, we have our house that was begun here. I think maybe last year, it's called Destiny Family. And on behalf of the Destiny Family, we are so grateful. Thank you very much. Indeed, you are humbled by your love. And my prayer is that the Lord God, He who words, open the way He rewards you. Amen. At any point, you may also need help. Let there be a person who be there for you. Thank you for the team, the committee that was led by Mayor Honorable Kinoti and St. John Martin, the treasurer, and many of you were in that committee. May the Lord indeed bless you. Mom is doing well. I should be going for the operations tomorrow. So let's pray for her as she goes for the operation tomorrow in India. Amen. Wanasifiwe. Right, we will do the rest of the preliminaries towards the end, but I feel we get into the word of the Lord. Because it is just the word of the Lord. Man shall not live by, later on back by, every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. I want to read Exodus chapter 14. I'll read from verse number 1, maybe up to verse number 20. And I will refer to many others thereafter. Bible says, now the Lord spoke to Moses saying, speak the children of Israel that they turn and come before Pihahiroth between Migdol and the sea, opposite Baal Zephon. You shall come before it by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they were bewildered by the Lord, and the wilderness has closed them in. Then I will harden Pharaoh's heart so that he will pursue them, and I will give gain, and I will gain honor over Pharaoh and over all his army, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord, and they did so. Verse number 5. Now it was told of the king of Egypt that the people had fled, and that the heart of the Pharaoh and his servants was turned against the people, and they said, why have we done this, that we have let Israel go from serving us? So he led his chariot and took his people with him. And also he took 600 choice chariots and all chariots of Egypt with captains over every one of them. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued the children of Israel. And the children of Israel went out with boldness. So the Egyptians pursued them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh, his horsemen and his army, and overtook them, camping by the sea beside Pihahiroth before Baal Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And they said to Moses, Because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us, way to die in the wilderness. Why have you so dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, don't be afraid, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see them no more, or you shall see them no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward, but lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And I indeed will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them. So I'll gain honor over Pharaoh and over his enemy, his army, his chariots, and his horsemen. Then the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gained honor for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his horsemen. Let me read verse 17 and 18 again, using another version. This is the Message Bible. It says, meanwhile, I'll make sure the Egyptians keep up their stubborn chase. I'll use Pharaoh and his entire army, his chariots and horsemen, to put my glory on display, so that the Egyptians will realize that I am God. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, thank you for your word. Pray that God, this morning you break this bread of life, that dear Father, each one of us will get that needed peace, dear Father, befits our need, that which we need this morning, dear Father, individually, dear Lord, and incorporate as a church, dear Father. I surrender myself to you, Holy Ghost. Use me as it pleases you. A vessel, dear Father, in your hands. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I've given this message. God is about to display his glory. I'm picking it from what Paul told Moses, that I'm going to do this to put my glory on display, so that the Egyptians will realize that I am the Lord. This morning I want to declare to somebody that God is about to display his glory over your situation and over your life. Because sometimes in this life, like for all of us, there comes times when we are kind of hemmed, we are kind of put in a tight corner, where situations look humanly impossible, where ourselves, in other words, sometimes we find in life ourselves in situations where we cannot go forward, we cannot go backward. It's like we are there, the end of our rope. We do not know what to do. We find ourselves in a situation we cannot turn this way or this side, because there are situations, there are circumstances that are surrounding us, and we wonder, God, where is the escape route? And this can be in any kind of scenario in our lives. It may be possible in your life. It may be in your business. It may be in your employment. You have a job that you're wondering, will I go there tomorrow, early morning? You know, and all these, and you're telling, I will go because, again, there are some bills to be paid anyway. Or it might be your marriage, and you're wondering, God, am I going to continue this way? What is the way forward? It's like we are in a place, a situation where we do not know what to do. We can't go forward, we can't go back, we can't get out of it. I'm here to declare this morning that God in that situation, God has put in that situation, if I may use that word, or God has allowed it, and God is not just allowing it, but he is also able to display his glory using that particular situation. Praise the Lord. And Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse number 12, he tells us, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial in which which is to try you, as though something strange is happening to you. But the Message Bible tells us, friends, and I like this, because this will happen to all of us at one particular time. This is not Job, it is 1 Peter 4:12. 1 Peter 4:12, the Message Bible says, friends, when lives get really difficult, don't jump to the conclusion that God isn't on the job. Because sometimes, believe it or not, sometimes situations come and they are difficult. But Bible is telling us, don't think that God is out of the job. He is still on the throne. He knows that which is happening. Amen. There may be pressure from every side of your life. And it's like you feel you're losing it and you're getting exhausted. There is no possibility of finding a way out of your situation. Or it may be a place whereby you've come to the end of your human ability and even in human resources. You look around, it's like you've come to the very end. This morning, I'd like to encourage you. Amen? But in that particular place where you find yourself and there seems to be no escape, no help, no place to run, no place to hide. You know, you have come to the very end. And it's like, this can't get better than this. The Lord is saying, He is just about to display His glory. Amen. Amen? Amen. As I speak this, I'm also encouraging myself. We got ourselves there in the last 2 weeks. But I'm telling you, God is a God of speed. Amen. Amen. If you've ever seen a God of speed, that is the God we serve. Because He is able to do, like I've said in the past, exceedingly, abundantly, above, beyond. You know, what you think or imagine. In fact, He says He is able to do super abundantly. That is the God of Messiah, the God of speed, the God who is able to display His glory in your situation. Praise the Lord. That's where we were sometimes ago, maybe the other week, we were dealing with my mom, we met my brothers, and there we are, and the doctors has kind of pushed us down, bless the doctors, and the report, and they will tell you, you know, this one, we cannot operate her, her age, and then we're going to give her medication, either the leg will get back or die, and all those things, and then it can happen. Amen? That's situation. But our God is a God. We still have to do so. Amen?
Yes.
To lift us up. Now, when I was thinking of this about, I thought about a very good snack that my wife sometimes makes in the house, called popcorns. You see, popcorns comes from a hard maize. Eh? See, it's a hard maize. And this hard maize is put at a heated pressure. When it's put at a heated pressure, it pops. That's why it's called popcorn, eh? And you enjoy it. Amen? You enjoy it. It is when you are put under heat and pressure that God is going to get a great snack out of you. Got a popcorn. Praise the Lord. God is just about to release something good out of you, even in your situation. You may be in the furnace. You may be under heat. You may be under pressure. But God is not yet through. What God is doing over your life, He is getting the best out of you. Praise the Lord. Help me preach to your neighbor. Tell your neighbor God is making a great snack out of your situation. That is who He is. He is making a great snack. You know, okay, when I say making you a great snack, you're ordering now a snack, do I? Then what happens? But that is the God whom we serve. Amen? God whom we serve. When we are subjected to that kind of pressure. And this is where the children of Israel get themselves in the scripture we have led. They have just been set free from captivity. And they're heading into the blessing of the Lord. They're heading into the promised land. And friends, even you and me, the moment we got born again, we began to walk with the Lord, we began to reach up with the Lord, we began our journey, yes, moving from Egypt to the promised land. The promised land may not be heaven, but the promised land is the walk you're walking right now when Jesus is on the throne and in control over your life. Amen?
Amen.
And as we were walking, just as they were walking, they got themselves in a place whereby they didn't know what to do. God has told them, when the verse number 2 says, God told them to turn. Tell them to turn. When God told them to turn, God knew. They were going forward, but God tells them, no, turn around. The whole issue was meant to confuse the enemy. Amen? And God will give you a student hope by telling you now, turn around, and the enemy will not even know who you are. And the Bible says, for now, I thought these guys are bewildered, but it's God who was about to do a new thing in their life.
Amen.
And so they get to an end whereby in front of them is a great sea. On the left side are mountains they cannot climb. On the left side is a great wilderness. They cannot go across. And behind is an enemy on hot pursuit. An enemy is coming. And then they are stuck. They are wondering, God, from here, where do we go to? And he turns back to Moses and starts complaining. But Moses tells him, hold on. Hold on. Let's see the salvation of the Lord. They were in the situation whereby, when I think about it, they had only one option out of three. The first option was to surrender to the enemy. And I declare to you this morning, in your situation, you don't have to surrender to the enemy because he has no power over your life. The second option was to fight the enemy. And I am also declaring you don't have to fight your enemy. After all, the enemy was a great enemy with chariots. Then the third option was just to trust God. And I want to recommend to you, in your situation, just trust God. It was not easy trusting God. These guys have been in Egypt. And in Egypt, they had gone through the desert. Most of their years, they were in the wilderness, in the desert. That means there was even no swimming pool. Right? So they didn't know how to swim. But now they're encountering a massive water. And God is telling them, move. And they're wondering, now these guys are coming, so we either die swimming, or we surrender and be taken back as slaves. But God is saying, he's about to do a new thing. Praise the Lord. And in your situation, your charity may be that big. You are looking at it, you don't know where to begin, where to end. You are surrounded by the enemy. An enemy is strong. In fact, the enemy may be scorning you or mocking you, telling you, why should you trust this God? Why are you trusting the Lord? How foolish it is to trust the Lord. He's telling you, you don't have to have faith in God. And sometimes we get ourselves here. You are here this morning and you do not know the Lord. An enemy has been whispering to you, you do not need to trust this God. You don't need to trust this God. Why put your faith in him? That is what the enemy sometimes whispers to us. And that is what he was doing to the Israelites. But God is saying, I just need you to put your trust in. By the way, sometimes it is people who are very close to us who will be mocking us, who will be telling us. Like Job. If you read Job chapter 2 verse 9, which was projected sometimes before, Job here, and his wife is telling him, my husband, you know, this is not a stranger, not a neighbor, not a relative. It is your or you are? Yeah. My husband, are you still holding on your precious integrity? Why not curse? Go and die. You know, and sometimes we get ourselves there. The enemy is mocking you. Why should you trust this God? Why should you give your life to him? And you hear that one coming even now and then. It is a high time you realize the enemy is just trying to destroy you. But God has a better plan for you. No wonder Isaiah tells us in Isaiah 40 verse 31, that them that wait upon the Lord, they don't suddenly lose their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. What is your situation this morning? What are you facing this morning? I have good news for you. You don't have to panic. Amen. Tell your neighbor you don't have to give up. You don't even have to ignore and pretend that the problem does not exist. I'm here to tell you, God is going to display his glory in your situation. Or let me use this word, how to acquisha. Amen. How to acquisha. You know, I said in the first service that some man, there was a lion, or rather there were not one, some lions that had broken loose, and there was one that was around Mombasa Road. And I imagine none of us would like to meet face to face with one of them. No, what you're saying, no, you don't want. You don't want. But then I remembered of this story of this preacher, somewhere in Meru, who told a man that if you meet a lion, go to the preacher. Baby? Preacher. And then he happened to meet the lion. And he knew. So he fell down. Quick. But the lion was not hungry. And so the preacher would say, even in Jerry, the same salad with you. Baba Chimba. Alikuwa mechimba. Chimba alikuwa mechimba. You see, I'm here to encourage you, my brother. How would you kusha? Amen. You need to move because somebody came and caught this man lying down. Akifikiri ya meisha. Somebody said, will I stop? I'm here to tell you, my friend, in aspiration, rise up and move on. Praise the Lord. Rise up and move on. And in the scripture we read, I want to bring to us three things that God told Moses to do so that God can show his glory, can display his glory. A threefold formula that God gave Moses and the Israelites. And I want to bring them to us and tell you this morning, if you do this, God indeed, he has promised, he is not a man that he may lie, neither a son of man that he can change his mind. What he says he'll do, he'll do it. God told them, number one, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. In other words, you don't need to surrender to the enemy. You don't have to surrender to the enemy. You don't have to fear. Because if there is anything that is dangerous, is fear. Because fear has the ability of taking control, you know, taking away our own control and putting us under the control of the fear. Fear has a way of kind of freezing us. We cannot move. You know, we're getting to a point whereby we either run away, we flee, and we freeze because of fear. And David is telling us in Psalms 23, verse number 4, that even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me, your rod and your staff do protect and comfort me. David is telling us that you don't need to get afraid. We have to fight fear. We have to say not to fear, because what fear does, fear cripples us. Fear makes sure you cannot be able to move. When you have fear, you don't even think. Amen. When there is fear, we do things that we cannot imagine. You ask yourself, are you the one? Amen. Sometimes you do things because of fear. Fear of what is going to happen. I got myself there on Wednesday. And after moving up and down, we got the visa for my mom on Tuesday. By Tuesday midnight, we were trying to book the train. We got the train on around midnight. Wednesday, we were to take her to see a doctor for reviews, like the doctor can say that she can fly, she can travel. By around 1, we were done with the doctor. I realized now, we cannot take back her where she was, because taking her to where my sister, where she was doing my sister in Wangigi, and it was a process because she's in a wheelchair, getting her from the wheelchair to the car, from the car, the wheelchair, from the wheelchair to the bed, and then it's about 1 hour, then you take again her, then begin the journey to the airport because of jam the airport. I told them, you go to the airport. That's what I'll do. Look for a hotel around Buko Mombasa Road. Good lunch. Let me go for the cloth. So I went to pick the cloth. Then I went through the bank. We had the ticket, but we had not paid. The money was in the bank. So when I went to the bank and I want to withdraw the money, I was told, you cannot get this money. Why? It's because there is a letter from the doctor you're supposed to bring. And you see now, at that point, fear. Fear of what is going to happen. The money is there. You can't get it. People have gone to the airport. They have to, but mama have to go. They have to go. You have bought the ticket. And you see, in that particular moment, You do not know what to. I am telling the manager, I need this money now. Now. And she is telling me, no, there is this letter. We gave you a week to look for the letter, which it is true, by the way. She had given us a week. But you see, that particular week we were running up and down, nobody remembered there was a letter. Then you see, at that particular point, fear can make you do what is imaginary, imagine, because it's a banker, it's a prostitute. She was right. But I told her, now, I need the money now. So close the account, give me my money. I need this account closed now. Because I need money now. And you see, now from that point on, we are not together. But finally, God intervened. But it was so tense because that was around 4. And we are supposed to be airport by 5:30. And it is Kasarani. And you know, bypass or Wake Road. So by 4 that's when we were clearing. I told God, it is now you. I need her. And by the way, God intervened in his own way. There was no jam the whole of Wake. The road that you don't expect. Not God, I'm going to go through this one. But clear them, clear. Within 45 minutes, I was in the airport. What I'm saying is, you know, fear can make you do things that, you know, you lose your senses. I later on went to apologize, including to everybody I missed, because for sure, there are many people that I missed, including when I was being sent, go here, and bless the Lord. Fear. When you operate in fear, fear cripples your thinking. But I'm here to declare this morning, you do not have to be afraid. God tells Moses, tell them not to be afraid. Do not be afraid. Hold on. I'm going to show my glory. My glory will be displayed. And for sure, the glory of the Lord was displayed. And I bless the Lord because he is able to do so. Amen. Because fear sometimes is like a shadow. And I remembered again when you were growing up. You know, when you were growing up, the rural areas, some of you never grew up in rural areas. Papa, you'll be sent at night to the shopping center. And there is some moonlight, you know, not very bright. So you can see a shadow. When you land, the shadow lands. When you stop, the shadow. And now there you are. Who is this? Because for sure you are seeing who you need to. Ukikibia? Anakibia. Ukisimama? You know, at that particular point, you are so fearful, you are crying. I mean, I would cry. Because now, I don't know what to move. Until you get somebody else around, then you see, that one I can now follow, that one I, then you run. And this morning, this is saying, you are not alone. Amen? You are not alone. Do not fear. Trust me. Follow me. Praise the Lord. And God is going to do it because he is faithful. Number two, he told them, don't fight. Don't fight. And I'm here to tell you, in your situation, God is going to display his glory, but do not fight. He told King Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 15 to 17. He tells them, listen, all you people. The best Bible says, he said, attention, everyone of you. And there are many things he tells them, that many people you can go to this alone. But tell them, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged by the mighty army. Do not be discouraged, do not fear. Hold on, and stand still. You don't need to fight this battle. Take your position, stand still, and see the victory of the Lord. You know, God is telling them, you don't have to fight the battle. The battle belongs to the Lord. The message Bible says, the war, victory. The war belongs to God. He is a God of war. You know, you do not have to fight. Watch God's saving work for you take shape. This is God's war. Yani, not yours. This is God's war, not yours. You don't have to fight. Because sometimes you are going through situations and you feel now like you can fight. You know, you have some muscles left. You can fight. You can tell people a few things. Amen?
Amen.
You don't have fight. Amen?
Amen?
You don't have to fight. Realize he is a God who is about to display his glory. It's not you to worry about. All things, the issues you're having, release them to the Lord. Allow the Lord to fight for you. And I would imagine the whole army, and they were told now, here, all you need to do is go up, and they're coming. But tomorrow, may tomorrow come now. Tomorrow, all you need to do is just stand. See what God is about to do. Just stand and see what God is about to do in your situation. Then number three, at the last one, he told them, move on. Amen. Move on in verse 15. Bible says, then Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving. Tell them to get moving. Tell them to move on. And I'm here to encourage somebody this morning. All you need to do in your situation, in that scenario, would you move on? Amen. And as you are moving on, God will begin the work. God will not work until you say, God, here I surrender to you. And I'm going to move on. I'm going to put my trust in you. Because the moment you do so, God begins to work. If you read verse 25 of Exodus 14, that is when you can see what God did. Because when God told them to move, and they began moving, and as they were moving, the enemy is coming. An enemy is coming at a speed. And God did realize this enemy is coming at a speed that will destroy my people. What God did, God went back. As they were moving, God went back and he became a mechanic. Amen. He became a mechanic. He came with a spanner. And he was loosening the nuts of the wheels of the chariot. 600 chariots. In other words, there was an angel on every chariot. An angel had a spanner. And a big spanner. What they were doing is removing the wheels. He made the wheels of the chariot to come off. So they were removing them. You see, when you want to the wheels to go off, you remove the wheels, not the nuts. And as he was loosening the nuts, the soldiers realized this thing is not moving now. The wheels are kind of wobbling. The speed is being used. I'm here to declare this month somebody, the Lord is reducing the speed of your enemy. Not only reducing the speed, but the Lord is stopping the enemy on your behalf. Because God realized this enemy is coming too fast. Let me go back and deal with this enemy. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And finally, you know the story. Not only did the wheel stop, but these guys, the enemy was destroyed. As you move, as you get busy with the Lord, as you move on, the Lord is going to stop the enemy on your behalf. Praise the Lord. You see, Paul tells us in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, when he had disarmed the rulers and authority, he made a public display. He's not only displaying his glory, but he's also making the enemy a public display that people can see that the enemy who was chasing you, you never see them anymore. No wonder he is telling them, the Egyptians you see today, you see them no more. And the Lord is saying, the enemy you see today, you will see them no more, because I am about to do a new thing. I'm about to do a new thing. Now God is telling them, all you need to do is burn. Move on. And as you move on, you see, one of the trouble that we do have is, when in a situation, you want to look left or right. Maybe you want to look to your friend. You want to look to the area MP or the MCA. They are good people. But God is telling them, look on, move forward. And I would imagine it's until they moved and got into the water that there was a way. Praise the Lord. God is saying, don't look left, don't look right. Move on forward. And God is going to fight your battles. I don't know what battles this morning you're fighting on your own. God is saying, is it time to have an exchange, that I can fight the battles on your behalf, because I'm more than able. Don't look back, because in Egypt, lay is just waste, and enemy is defeated. There is nothing to go back to Egypt. There is nothing good to look back in Egypt. You do not have to surrender to your enemy. We have to move on. Praise the Lord. I want us to rise up. I want us to pray. I may not know what is your situation, but I know our God is a great big God. Amen. He's a God who's more than able. More than able to fight every battle that you are going. I want to welcome the worship team to come and help us. And as we worship the Lord, I want to pray with a number of people here before we wind up. I want to pray with you here this morning, you're not born again. And Egypt is not where you should be. For sure, Egypt just means destruction for you. But you want to trust God. You want to believe God. You're not born again, you want to give your life to Jesus. That is the best you can be able to do. You can't fight these battles on your own. You need God to fight the battles for you. In fact, he is saying, don't fight. Allow me to fight for you. The enemy may look so big. And just like Job was told, you don't need to trust God. Maybe you have spoken to yourself, and maybe the enemy is speaking to you, telling you, why put your faith in this God? Why? This morning, this is a God that you need to put your faith in, because he is more than able. He is saying, just release and surrender to me. I'm more than able and willing to do exceedingly, even beyond what you can think about. That is the God whom we serve. Praise the Lord. And also, as we worship the Lord, you're here this morning, and you're in a situation whereby you're in a place whereby you're feeling you're not moving forward, you're not going backward. It's like you are where the Israelites were. You do not know what to do. God is saying this morning, he will fight your battles. If we surrender our battles to him, he's going to fight your battles. He is saying, don't fight. He is saying, don't be afraid. He is saying, move on. Allow me to take over, that I can show you my glory. Because that is what God is going to do for us. If we just lift up our hands together and worship the Lord for a minute, tell God that which you want him to do for you, because he is faithful as you worship him.
When the oceans rise and
Shine, you master, and it's not like you, dear Lord. Oh, mighty, holy, beautiful. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we want to thank you, give you praise this morning. There is no other God beside you. Oh, blessed be your name. And as you close our eyes and you're praying this morning, I want to ask you here, you're not born again, and you want to trust this great God. You want to ask the Lord to fight your battles for you. You're not born again, you want to give your life to Jesus. And I ask you to lift up your hand. You're saying, Lord, I want to surrender to you. You want to surrender to the Lord this morning. And I want to pray with you. Are you there? You want to give your life to Jesus? Just lift up your hand wherever you are, receive it. And believe God for you. That God is able to fight every battle. You don't have to fight on your own. He is willing. Are you there? Thank you, Lord. You're here, you want God to intervene in your situation. You're saying, I'm in a place whereby you just need God to intervene. Let God be fighting your battles, that you want the Lord God, you want God to display his glory. You want him to fight your battles as he did for King Jehoshaphat and the Israelites. Say, God, here I am. I need you to fight this battle. If you lift up your hand, I'm going to pray with you as you ride up. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are lifting up our hands to you, dear Father. Lord God, because we acknowledge that this battle belongs to you. And Lord God, you want to do an exchange. We do not need to fight this battle, dear Lord. Jehovah, we want to surrender to you. We do not want to be afraid. We want to push away fear and, dear Father, put our trust in you. And I want to pray for my brother. I pray for my sister. I'm asking of you, Jehovah, Lord, that God, you will come down as you did it for the Israelites, dear Lord. I want to pray, dear Father, not only reducing the speed of the enemy, dear Lord, that has been targeting my brother, not only reducing the speed, dear Father, but I pray today that enemy, dear Father, our King, shall be destroyed now in the name of Jesus. And you are putting an end, dear Lord, to the enemy. As you did for the Israelites, dear Lord, do for your people this morning in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. You told the Israelites to stand still and see the deliverance and the salvation of you, dear Lord. And mighty God, you fought their father, their battles. I pray today, fight our battles, dear Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, show forth your power, show forth your glory, show forth your Father and our King. Oh God, you display your glory, dear Lord, over our lives, dear Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want to thank you and give you praise, dear Lord, for answering our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Receive your victory in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We can take our seat. Thank you very much. Before I invite the leader of the service, I want me to do one or two things. Jemima is going to Tanzania next week. Can we pray for you now? Tell us where you're going.